So today, in 1914, Woodrow Wilson made Mother's Day a national holiday. So Mother's Day in the United States is a national holiday starting in 1914. On May 12, 1907, before that, this is the runner-up part, Anna Jarvis held a memorial service at her church, actually her mother's church, for her mother. It was a Methodist church. And because of the work that her mother had done through her life, she wished to remember her mother's heart during the service. And from there, she actually campaigned through public officials to create an actual holiday, a national holiday for that. Before then, there were churches all over the United States that opened their doors to recognize a mother's heart because of this first memorial service. Anna's mother was Ann Reeves Jarvis. And around 1852, she started these Mother's Day work clubs. So they are a group of women who got together to improve sanitary conditions for those that were living in the community, mostly because the child mortality rate was so atrocious at that time. Many children didn't make it to 5 years old. So Anne Reeves Jarvis recognized that part of that was due to cleanliness and due to nutrition and hygiene. And she, as a group of other women and other mothers, helped ill mothers. So let's say a mother became ill, they would go in and help the family. If something were to happen, they made sure milk was inspected so that children received good milk and not spoiled milk. All these things we kind of take for granted today, but this was a concerted effort for the community. She kept this club together even during the Civil War. So, and during the Civil War, she decided and got the mothers and the families that were helping her to agree that they would not discriminate which side they were helping. Everyone would get help. So it didn't matter if you were on the Confederate side or the Union side, you would receive help for your family. There was still an effort for sanitation, for getting people food, for making sure people lived the best life they could, despite what was going on around them. This held all the way through to the end of the Civil War, and in 1865, the first Mother's Friendship Day was born. And at this Friendship Day, it was families coming together, soldiers from both sides, sitting down, having a picnic with the women that were keeping their families going. She made sure to say it didn't matter what your political side was, what your social side was, that humanity and community is what made it. She exemplified the feminine divine, the sacred feminine heart. She also helped those that were grieving. Not only did she help people because of the sanitary needs, but she felt those herself. So of the six children that she bore, four of them passed because of disease. So she was in the midst of not only grieving, but also helping so others didn't feel the same or have that the same. Now her daughter Anna is the one that overheard her when she was really young saying that she hopes that someday, her mother said out loud, she hopes that someday that all of the women, the mothers, were recognized, because she really recognized that at that time in our history, in world history, not just the United States, a feminine contribution to society was often overlooked or was considered second tier, even despite everything that you could see that she was doing. So that's what Anna set out to do and why the memorial service happened. Again, her mother, and Anna for that matter, exemplified things like intuition, compassion, wisdom, collaboration, reflection, creativity, kindness, gentleness, all the characteristics we recognize as that divine feminine, the feminine aspect of everybody, not just women, everybody. It is not gender specific. All genders carry that feminine quality of creation in them. So again, we're going to call this the mother's heart, since it is Mother's Day. And in this creation of the universe, of universal consciousness, you know, there is created both feminine and masculine. And next month when we hit Father's Day, we'll talk about the divine masculine. The masculine will get its due. But to recognize that there is a yin and a yang there, that they are to be balanced, and that one is more important than the other, is really important. These qualities, again, can be found in any gender. And a mother has become that symbol of everything that is possible. Much of human history, however, just like we said, has been patriarchal in form. And we've often, you know, pushed under the rug a lot of things that have happened. And Lawrence Gaillian, I hope I said his name right, it's G-A-L-I-A-N. He wrote the books Jesus, Muhammad, and the Goddess and the 40 Gnostic Truths. He said, what happened to our divine feminine through history? Why has she apparently disappeared from Judaism, Christianity, and Islam? In the Gnostic Gospels, we learn that Mary Magdalene was probably the closest disciple of the Christos, the one whom the master taught the most arcane and esoteric wisdom. She was and is the representation of all wisdom. The male apostles of the Christos demonstrated both their jealousy and respect for the wisdom and position of Mary Magdalene. Charles Fillmore, in the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary, also talks about Mary Magdalene and her place as one of our recognition of divine feminine. He says, a wonderful lesson of consistency, gratitude, love, faithful attachment, and service is set before us in the glimpse of Mary Magdalene that are given in the Gospels. Wherever she is mentioned, the power of love, devotion, and service is revealed. Her whole life and all that she had were apparently dedicated to the Christ. The soul consciousness in each individual is capable of the strongest, deepest, and fullest alliance to this truth. It is constantly seeking something that will satisfy. It can never be happy or at peace until the feelings are redeemed and harmonized by the Holy Spirit, until God's presence is known, felt, and fully realized throughout the individual being, the feminine and the masculine. Charles Fillmore also says, we may have been inclined to belittle the value of the feminine side of our nature, the feelings and affections, which are the seat of emotions in our unredeemed state, belong to the soul. The purification of the soul and the wealth of its devoted, sustaining qualities are needed in regeneration of the body, as much as it is the quickening of the disciples, the 12 faculties of the mind. So again, we talked about the powers and the faculty of the mind the last few weeks, and that's very much in the realm of the masculine, right? And Charles Fillmore is saying, you need to take that and wrap it up with the soul understanding of the feminine. The love and the wisdom must enter into all of that in order for us to become that trueness, substance of life. He says, without the depths of the feeling, the emotions, the quality in the soul conscious, with Mary Magdalene seems especially to symbolize, we should be like one before whom a table is prepared for a great feast. The table is laid with the fine linen and silver, and all the dishes and arrangements are perfect. But there is nothing to eat. or if there should be something to eat, it would be as a food without flavor or seasoning. We need that depth of love and feeling. We need that feminine nature in order to bring about a fullness in that spiritual diet. And that's what we celebrate today. And I think that's what really that first Mother's Day was all about. As an aside, poor Anne, who created the first Mother's Day through that recognition of her mother's work, later in her life would argue against the National Mother's Day because of how commercialized it had become. She was like, this is not what it's about. It was about recognizing all these good works and this love and not making sure, you know, we offer all these gifts. Now, the gifts are nice. I'm not saying that. But the realization from the person that wanted this holiday so badly in recognition that fought against it later, I think is striking in how we recognize that feminine nature. And that it really was set in place to create a sense of there is power in that feminine nature, and a power that we all share, again, through all genders, and not to discount that. So in honoring Mother's Day, we recognize past, present, and future, all those who have expressed this mother's heart, the heart of the qualities of the sacred feminine. I'm going to find this other quote I have for you. Ananda Karnesh, he wrote 1,000 Seeds of Joy. He said, a matriarchal world does not mean matrilineal or that one queen shall rule the world. He says it simply means a world in which a mother's heart leads all social institutions, cooperations, and governments. All humans, men, women, or transgender, can embody a mother's heart if they choose. We are destined for extinction as a human race unless a mother's heart assumes the leadership of the world. We need that compassion and that peace wrapped up in all those thoughts of the mind and all the individualism. The feminine side of creation is that coming together, that oneness piece. The masculine, again, which we'll talk about more next month, is the individualized part, and we are both. And we often forget that oneness part to bring our individual nature into each other in order to bring about those changes, in order to create space for togetherness and conversation, facilitating healing, even after any kind of conflict, just like Anne did after the Civil War. We recognize this heart as a place of strength. We recognize as co-creators, as manifestations of this divine universe, that we all have this, and we are charged to use it. We are charged to tap into these characteristics and to create that wholeness between our mind, our body, and our spirit, and all creation, for our family, our community, expressing wisdom, compassion, and gentleness. Andrew Harvey said, the future of the world depends on the full restoration of the sacred feminine in all its tenderness, passion, divine ferocity, and surrendered persistence. And this even goes for, again, it's all genders, but I think sometimes we forget or we put those that are women that do not have children on a side that's not as equal sometimes, especially when we talk about Mother's Day. And I have several friends that have expressed this in the last week. It's always interesting leading up to Mother's Day and listening to people, because there's either this joyful, I love my mother and all this is great, right? Or I hear the other side where they just can't get their heads around the day. Either their mother has passed, or they didn't have a good relationship, Or maybe they don't have children and they're being told by their families that they're somehow less. And this happens around this time of year all the time. There's this great joy aspect and this great, I just don't want anything to do with it. And I think if we remember the divine feminine aspect of all of us, we can bring those together. There's a lovely lady who does a lot of blogging and work. Her name is Venda Maria. She's one of these people that has chosen to not have children. And yet she's one of the biggest advocates for the divine feminine, I think, at least in social media type circles. She says, when we connect to the divine feminine in each and every one of ourselves, we discover that in fact, we are wholehearted after all. We are wholehearted, and that's the joy aspect of the mother's heart. And we don't need to have a certain way that we live our lives in order to express that and live that. Even if we don't have children in our care, we all have the possibility to be motherly to each other, to use, to accept that sacred feminine space. He's so cute. So again, to tie a little bow around it, enjoy the day in whichever way is right for you. I know one of the reasons there's carnations in the mix is one color is to honor the living mothers of our lives, and one is the past mothers of our lives. And whether that's a biological mother or a spiritual mother or some person in your life that has nurtured you in any way, to honor that aspect of them and yourself today, and to move forward with that and take that out into the world, just like Anna did in her own life. Thank you.